Welcome to Pulaski Heights United Methodist Church, and thank you for being a part of our television ministry. Pulaski Heights is a place of warmth and love, with an outreach mission that extends far beyond our church walls. We have a long tradition of offering our hearts, stretching our minds, and extending Christ's hands to those in need. We are a congregation of hope and an open place of worship that seeks to share the good news beyond the conventional barriers of fellowship.
Hi, I'm Britt Scarta, senior pastor at Pulaski Heights United Methodist Church. It is our desire that you will be inspired by today's message of hope for a diverse community in search of God's love.
Oh, give thanks to God and call on God's name. Make known God's deeds among the people. Sing to God. Sing praises to God Almighty. Tell of God's wonderful works. Glory in the divine name. Let the hearts of those who seek life rejoice. And now, people of God, share the peace of Christ with those around you. May be seated. Brothers and sisters in Christ, through the sacrament of baptism, we are initiated into Christ's holy church. We are incorporated into God's mighty acts of salvation and given new birth through water and the Spirit. All of this is God's gift offered to us without price. It is my honor and joy this morning to present Price McKay Quirtabitty for the sacrament of baptism. And now, Molly and Jonathan, on behalf of the whole church, I ask you, do you renounce the spiritual forces of wickedness, reject the evil powers of this world, and repent of your sin? If so, please say, I do. Do you accept the freedom God gives you to resist evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever forms they present themselves? If so, please say, I do. Do you confess Jesus Christ as your Savior, put your whole trust in His grace, and promise to serve Him as Lord in union with the church, which Christ has opened to all people, to people of all ages, nations, and races? If so, please say, I do. Will you nurture this child in Christ's holy church, that by your teaching and example, she may be guided to accept God's grace for herself, to profess her faith openly, and to lead a Christian life? If so, please say, I will. And now to you. Will you nurture one another in the Christian faith and life and include this person now before you in your care? If so, please say, we will. We will.
Good morning, Price. How are you? You are such a beautiful girl. And I want you to meet some beautiful people. This is your new family. This is the family of God. This is the family of Christ. And we are here today to worship God, give thanks for Christ's presence in our lives. But we also come today to celebrate with you and your baptism. They're great looking people, aren't they? And you're a beautiful girl, and you are going to grow up and learn the scriptures. You're going to learn the faith, and then one day you're going to claim it for yourself. And we hope that a lot of these people will be a major part of that growing up. What do you think? Isn't she wonderful? And she's so good.
She's really so good.
Are you always this good? I know you are. I can tell by looking at you. Yeah. So, church, this is Price. Price, this is the church. Lord, pour out your Holy Spirit on this gift of water and on Price who receives it. Wash away her sin and clothe her in righteousness, that by dying and being raised from the dead, she will become a faithful disciple of Jesus Christ. Amen. One more time. You ready?
Bryce McKay, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Bryce McKay, the Holy Spirit work within you that having been born through water and the Spirit, you may become a faithful disciple of Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. And now it is our joy to welcome our new sister in Christ. So let us join in our response. With joy and thanksgiving, we welcome you into Christ's holy church, for we are all one in Christ Jesus our Lord. We promise to love, encourage, nurture, and support you, and to help you know and follow Christ.
At this time, I'd like to invite our young Christians, our children, forward as we sing together. Everybody. I'm so glad you all are here this morning. So what's special about this week? That's right, no school. Hey! Yeah! All right, but really, Thanksgiving. But do you know, we know that you'll have, maybe some of you will go somewhere for Thanksgiving. Some of you will have family come to your house. Some of you will eat together as a family. You'll have different food than usual in many cases. But do you ever really stop to think about what you're thankful for? You know, and that's right, we don't. So I want to encourage you, this is not just a one time a year thing to talk about what we're thankful for, is it? I mean, this should be something we do daily. You know, earlier this week, I had the seniors, the kids that are graduating in May, over to my house for a Thanksgiving dinner. And one of the things we did was we passed around an empty cup and we poured grape juice into it. And with each pour of the grape juice, we talked about what we're thankful for. And then we had communion using that cup of our Thanksgivings, of what we were thankful for. You know, so a lot of people said their family. What do you think other people said? What are you thankful for? For your friends? Who said something over here? You? Family?
I'm thankful for my teacher, Mrs. Lyon.
Your teachers, that's right. Who had something over here? Yes, sir.
Education.
For education.
I'm thankful for
family and friends.
Family and friends?
For Jesus? For what? Shelter? Yes. For God?
Everything.
For everything, yes. Friends? Does that sum it up? Emmy, what were you going to say?
Food?
Food?
Church?
Church? Yes.
Water.
Yes. Yes. So we're thankful for lots of things. In fact, I had a list of 10 things, just in case you all didn't have anything to say. And you covered all 10 of them. So I know that you're thankful. So maybe when you sit down with your family or friends or whoever you're sitting down for Thanksgiving dinner with, you might take a cup and pour some juice into it or milk or whatever until that cup is overflowing because we have so many things to give thanks for. And all of that comes from God, right? There's a scripture, Psalm 118, that says, "Give thanks to God, for God is good. God's love is forever." And so we should give as much thanks as we can back to God. Will you pray with me? God, we're so grateful for everything you do in our lives. We're thankful this Thanksgiving week for so many things. Help us to be thankful and grateful people, not just the week of Thanksgiving, but every morning when we wake up and every night when we go to sleep. We ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Have a great week and happy Thanksgiving, boys and girls.
Lord be with you.
Also with you.
Let us pray. We confess we stand before the door, O God, and hear your voice and wrestle with whether or not to open the door and let you in. We stand on the riverbank and yearn for the courage to take the first step to cross to the other side. We are besieged with doubts and trepidation and linger in the safety of the solid ground. Help us, we pray, to breathe in deeply the memories of our past, to fortify us for what lies ahead. Keep us mindful of our heritage and those who have gone before us. Let us therefore move forward with hope, borrowing on the strength of all that has been, so that we might give witness to all that is to be. Lord, as we approach this week of Thanksgiving, hear our prayers for those who grieve the loss of a loved one. We pray for and offer our Christian sympathy to Jean Schmidt and family in the death of her father, Henry Schmidt, to Sarah Cook and family in the death of her grandmother, Mary Jo Burnett, and to the family and friends of Frances Chastain in her recent death. We also pray for those who are sick in body, mind, or spirit, and for these who have been hospitalized recently, Dr. Mac Moore and Mark Wilson. We rejoice and give thanks for the birth of Addison Mary Mitchell, child of Jessica and Clint Mitchell, and grandchild of Mary Carolyn and Tom East. We rejoice in the baptisms of Theodore Joseph Beck, child of Jenny and Daniel Beck, Isaiah Wesley Calamese, child of Tamara and Darren Calamese, Nora Glory Gwynn, child of Amanda and Chad Gwynn, Saunders Stewart Irby, child of Elizabeth and Stewart Irby, Lucille May Kuntz, child of Carrie and Nathan Kuntz, and of William Beckett Smith, child of Sayward and Bryant Smith. In the ebb and flow of the tides of life, O God, let us always remember that you call us by name and we are yours. Help us to remember that we are held safely in your love through Christ our Lord, who taught us to say when we pray, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen."
Amen. You are invited to stand for the reading of the scripture, which is Joshua chapter 3, verses 14 through 17 in the Old Testament. When the people set out from their tents to cross over the Jordan, the priests bearing the Ark of the Covenant were in front of the people. Now the Jordan overflows all its banks throughout the time of harvest. So when those who bore the Ark had come to the Jordan, and the feet of the priests bearing the Ark were dipped in the edge of the water, the waters flowing from above stood still, rising up in a single heap far off at Adam, the city that is beside Zarethan, while those flowing toward the Sea of Arabah, the Dead Sea, were wholly cut off. Then the people crossed over opposite Jericho. While all Israel were crossing over on dry ground, the priests who bore the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord stood on dry ground in the middle of the Jordan until the entire nation finished crossing over the Jordan. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Please be seated. Of all the amusement park thrill rides I've experienced in my life, the roller coaster, the Ferris wheel, the skydiver, the whip, my favorite by far is the water slide. Water slides are kind of like roller coasters, only wet. There's no cart to ride in, there's no track to ride on, there are no restraint belts, but it's very much like it. With water slides, the rider is carried along by the sheer force of gravity, as well as by the water itself. There's something terribly exciting and exhilarating, as well as frightening, to allow ourselves to be propelled down a water slide from top to bottom, from beginning to end, with no restraints whatsoever. It's not for the faint-hearted. While I've never ridden on it, I've never seen it or experienced it, I've been told that the 12-story Summit Plummet, located at Walt Disney World in Orlando, Florida, is the most amazing water slide ever. As a matter of fact, I've been told that those who are strong-hearted and hardcore thrill seekers often find their knees weak when they reach the top and they look at that 100-foot free fall. It's frightening. In case you didn't know, the Jordan River that runs through Israel and Palestine and Jordan is very much like a water slide. It has many of the same characteristics, and as a result, it deserves the same kind of respect and fear. The Jordan River begins into the north. Its headwaters are located atop Mount Hermon, 9,000 feet above sea level. And they rush down, they cascade down at an amazing rate, and finally end up in the Dead Sea, 1,400 feet below sea level. The name Jordan comes from the Hebrew word Yarden, which means to descend, to descend. The Jordan River is one of the fastest rivers of its size on the planet. And a trip down the Jordan can be something of a thrill ride, especially during the harvest time when the banks overflow. My first ever experience of the Jordan River left me finding myself literally in the middle of that river. Literally in the middle of the river. Two of our Pulaski Heights United Methodist Church Holy Land pilgrims wanted to renew their baptism in the Jordan River, the place where Jesus himself had been baptized. And so I officiated, wearing nothing more than swim trunks and one of these light, flimsy, "Oh brother, where art thou? Let's all go down to the river to pray" white gowns. It was January. And as I slipped into that water, I thought I would freeze to death. The gown floated atop the Jordan for just a moment, and then it sank, and it stuck to my skin like frost on a windshield. Barefooted, I struggled to even keep my foothold. And with the swift waters and the debris passing by, I feared that I might be swept away and end up dead in the Dead Sea. The Bible, according to the Bible, water is to be both revered and feared. Revered and feared. In Psalm 23, we're told that the good shepherd takes us along quiet, tranquil waters and restores our soul. Even as Psalm 69 warns us that waters can cover us in a flood and drown us and take us away. 4 decades before Joshua led the Israelites across the waters of the Jordan River, Moses had led the Israelites through the waters of the Red Sea in order to escape the oppression and the slavery they experienced under Pharaoh. And so by the time Joshua is prepared to lead the Israelites, the people of God, have been wandering in the wilderness for 40 years. 40 years. It's time for a change. It's time to move on. It's time for a new vision. It's time for a new dream, a bigger dream, a better dream. And that's what we have before us. When the people set out from their tents to cross over the Jordan, the priests bearing the Ark of the Covenant were in front of the people. Now the Jordan overflows all of its banks throughout the time of harvest. So when those who bore the ark had come to the Jordan, and the feet of the priests bearing the ark were dipped in the edge of the water, the waters flowing from above stood still, rising in a single heap. Many biblical scholars, like to think of this crossing of the Jordan River as a bookend to the crossing of the Red Sea. And it makes sense. It makes sense. What began with Moses and the plagues in Egypt and the drowning of Pharaoh's army in the middle of the Red Sea comes to a grand conclusion with the rise of new leadership in Joshua, a new commander-in-chief who leads the Israelites safely across the Jordan River to freedom. It makes sense. It makes sense. Both stories are similar. Both stories involve miraculous parting of great waters. Both stories are fast and furious, like a water slide. But this story, the story of the crossing of the Jordan, is so much more than a bookend. It was a powerful story. And has a powerful lesson in and of itself. In the same way that the crossing of the Red Sea marked a new beginning for God's people, so the crossing of the Jordan River marks yet another new chapter, another new beginning for God's people. In the same way that crossing the Red Sea washed away Israel's identity as a nation of slaves, so the crossing of the Jordan River marks the washing away of the children of Israel as homeless wanderers. They cross over. They're in the Promised Land. Something new, something beautiful, something incredible is happening. A bigger, better dream than they ever thought possible. And so it always has been. And so it always will be. The writer of Hebrews tells us that Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Truer words were never spoken. But the way we bear witness, the way we share the story of Jesus with the world, is always changing. It's rushing past us like the Jordan River, like the summit plummet water slide. It's always moving on rapidly. And I know. As the senior pastor of Pulaski Heights United Methodist Church, I have a distinct advantage that so many other, most senior pastors around this nation do not have. Because I've served here twice. I was appointed an associate pastor in the late 1980s and more recently in 2010 as senior pastor. And so my memory of this congregation, this church, spans almost 30 years. And I still remember, I knew so many of the movers and shakers that made this congregation, this great church, what it is even to this day. Names like Harold Engstrom. Harold's so instrumental in building this facility. Harold and Martha used to sit right over there. And Hoyt and Wanda Pyle, gracious saints of the church, so giving, so loving, they sat right down here. And Ernestine McKinney, a mover and shaker, not only locally but globally, sat right over there. And Catherine Smurl. Catherine was the first baby baptized in this church when it was organized down the street in 1912. I knew Catherine, and she and her husband Orville were here every week. And I remember Dr. James B. Argue, pastor emeritus, served this church longer than any pastor in its history, started the broadcast ministry. As an associate, Dr. Argue and Ann sat right down here. It was intimidating. That's why I don't use the pulpit even to this day. What great stories. And we still have that continuity with people like Reverend Victor Nixon and Freddie Nixon who continue to support and participate and lead in this congregation. I mean, and who can forget the story of Mrs. Herbert Smith, who when the male members and the leaders of this church said, this place can't be built, it's not possible, we don't have the money, we can't do it. Mrs. Smith stood up in a business meeting and she said, you businessmen think churches are built with money, churches are built with faith. I move we begin construction immediately, and we did, and this is the result today. Over the last 105 years, there have been hundreds of people who have made this a bigger and better place with a bigger and better dream. Fast forward to this year. Fast forward to a meeting when this congregation came together and unanimously voted to include St. Luke United Methodist Church in Broadmoor as a second campus. And furthermore, to create a quality child care center for disadvantaged children from disadvantaged families at the cost of over the $500,000 in renovations. The vote was unanimous. Hey, Moses and Joshua never got that kind of buy-in. I don't know if you know it or not, but you're standing, you're sitting in the midst of a miracle. The midst of a miracle. I mean, kingdoms topple, and political systems fade away, and earthly institutions lose their value and their support and their love by the people, but the church of God is forever. And it continues to proclaim the good news of Jesus Christ crucified and risen. And that's what this church does, and that's what we believe, and it's what we see the fruits of. Even today, our exploding children and youth ministries, all of our other ministries and mission, the love within this place, the love not only that we have for one another, but for those beyond our walls. This church has made a commitment to be inclusive, to open its door to all people, to welcome all people and say, you are a part of the body of Christ. You are loved. And so as you make your commitments today, later in the service, I want to thank you. I want to thank you for your giving. I want to thank you for your generosity. I want to thank you for being a part of this great church. I want to thank you for your willingness to step into the waters and to cross the Jordan so that this church might continue to build a bigger dream. Amen.
Well, good morning. My name is Mike Ross, and this is my wife, Holly, and we approve this message because we're proud to be members of this awesome church family. You know, the first time we joined Pulaski Heights, quite frankly, I must confess, was out of convenience. Oh, we're Methodist. My great-great-grandfather was a Methodist circuit rider who brought our family here to Arkansas in 1836, the same year we became a state and pastored in places like Central at Fayetteville and Camden and small communities in southwest Arkansas as well. So we were Methodist, but the truth is our very first house that we purchased as a newly married couple was right across the street at the corner of Lee and North Monroe. I'm a little directionally challenged, but I think it was that way. If you notice, there's stairs right there that lead up to the church. I might have had something to do with that. We were finishing college in the 80s, and we were members until about a year after our firstborn, Sydney, or Sydney Beth back then, was baptized here just a few feet away at the baptismal. And it was Christmas morning, 1988. God had other plans for us, so we moved back home to South Arkansas, where we raised our family over the next 23 years. And we're active members of the First United Methodist Church in Prescott. And then 5 years ago, as I was leaving Congress, we relocated to Little Rock. And this time we chose Pulaski Heights, not out of convenience, as we now live not across the street, but about 20 minutes away in West Little Rock.
We chose Pulaski Heights because we knew it would be a buzz with activity every day, year-round with loving, giving, inclusive community of Christ. Each day, Pulaski Heights is like a beehive of activity from worship to ministry to mission. It is a place where love is administered through childcare, senior activities, community basketball, exercise groups, Boy Scouts, music classes, youth group activities, and so much more. We are the beehive for community caring, such as our homeless missions, AA, prison ministry, including providing transportation for young children to be able to visit their parents in prison, the food pantry, helping to feed the community here at home, and our medical mission and disaster relief globally. And now we have this same buzz of activity surrounding our St. Luke campus as well. Pulaski Heights is a place where every individual can find a way to be an instrument of worship, ministry, and mission.
We were members less than a month when Holly was asked to be a pharmacist on the medical mission to Guatemala. And she'll be going on that mission for her sixth time this coming July. We knew at Pulaski Heights our gifts would be used to sustain the beehive that is our church. It was important for us to be a part of a church that understands these needs. But these programs can only occur if there are resources from which to administer them. And that means money and volunteers. As individuals, we can't do much on our own. But if we give our gifts and time together, collectively, as one church family, we can accomplish so much more as the community of Christ. I'll be honest with you. After the 2014 election, I thought I was done asking for money. And I used to dread these stewardship campaigns, coming to church and hearing people tell me how I needed to give more. But as a member of the Finance Committee here at Pulaski Heights, I now have a greater appreciation and understanding that we cannot do the things that we do in worship, ministry, and mission without the funds necessary to carry them out. Pledges are a critical part of how we plan our ministries and missions and sustain this worship service and these facilities. If you pledge, please make a commitment today for 2018. If you didn't pledge this year, please prayerfully consider making a pledge today for 2018. And I want to ask you to please, on the pledge card, there's a box. I am interested in establishing an EFT, electronic funds transfer withdrawal. That means they just take the money out of your checking account every month at a time of your choosing, much like you pay a lot of other bills, And I want to tell you why that is so important now more than ever, because we're a mobile society and people travel and people do things, and the summer months are really challenging. The bills don't stop coming in. We don't stop the missions, the worship, the ministries, but a lot of people are at the lake, they're on vacation, and they eventually catch up usually, but it really puts the church in a bind at times. And Razorback game weekends used to be a problem. Not so much today. And then there's hunting season, and the list goes on and on. So please consider doing that. I was reluctant to do it, but I'm glad I did it. And I know the church receives the resources they need to continue the work even when we're not here, and we do miss some. You know, to whom much is given, much is expected. And whether you're a young person with an allowance from your parents, a young couple starting your career, if you're at the pinnacle of your career, or if you're retired, all of us are truly blessed. I think it's important to pause and remember that half the world lives on less than $2 a day. And I do believe that what we've been given has been given to us by God, and that we do have an obligation to give back to those less fortunate than us. So we're grateful that Pulaski Heights listens to God and always looks for ways to meet the needs of others. The work of this church is about so much more than four worship services on Sunday morning. Pulaski Heights is truly committed to worship, ministry, and mission 7 days a week. Please help our church continue being the hands and feet of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, by making a pledge today for next year. And please consider the EFT box. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Holly, and thank you, Mike. Two things before we pray over our offering. Hang on to your pledge cards, as there will be another act of giving later in the service. And also, I encourage you to fill out and place your Connect card in the offering plate as it comes by you, as this is such a big Sunday, and we'll be following up with those who have not placed this in the offering plate. Will you go to God in prayer with me? God, we know you are our provider. Your word creates our life and strength. Everything we have is a gift from your open hand. And we ask you to guide us by your Spirit, to be diligent and faithful stewards of all that you entrust to our care. Fill our hearts with trust, so that we can experience your joy in giving. May we, this congregation, show your generosity through our mission in the world, and all of this for the sake of Jesus Christ. Amen.
seated. We come to this time as we close out our service today to bring our commitments forward that we give to honor God and the ministries of Christ Church here at Pulaski Heights. If you're a guest today, we have been honored by your presence. Of course, we don't want you to bring a card. We simply want you to enjoy and be blessed by this community together. If you're members and you're not prepared to do that or unable to do that, that's fine as well. This is for those who have made that commitment. We invite you to bring your gifts forward, coming as the Spirit leads you, not directed by ushers, by the center aisles to leave your cards and return by the side aisles. Would you pray with me? God, bless these gifts that come forward. May they be used to the advancement and glory of your kingdom. In your name we pray. Amen.
Thank you for joining us today at Pulaski Heights United Methodist Church. And I hope you enjoyed our worship service. May the peace, joy, and love of God be with you.